Good evening, everyone. Going to call to order the regular Planning Commission meeting for February 14th, 2017. All please rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I would like to thank SCTV for recording the proceedings of this meeting. And now I'll take the roll call. Holly Bem. Anderson. Robert Kulikowski.
Here.
Aaron Levitt Smith.
Here.
Ron LeCandro. Absent. Alan Needham.
Here.
William Rice. Present. Elizabeth Burt.
Here.
Mark Drake. Absent. Gary Lungarini, absent. Okay, so I have 1, 2, 3, 4 regular members of the commission. Elizabeth, I'd like to appoint you from the alternate to a full member for this meeting. Okay. Next on the agenda, approval of minutes. We have had two meetings since our last meeting on January 24th. So we have the 24th, and then there was a special meeting on February 7th, in which the commission discussed the progress of the update for the plan of conservation and development. So, Mr. Kulikowski, would you please, Holly Bem is now here. Okay, Elizabeth, you still please remain a full member. So okay. Now we have six members of full commission. Mr. Kulikowski, please lead us through the minutes of the meeting.
Okay. The minutes for the January 24th regular Planning Commission meeting, 2017. Any additions or changes on page one? Page 2.
Line 64.
64.
Levitt is spelled incorrectly.
Page 3. Accept the minutes as amended.
May I ask a question? I'm sorry, I missed this on page 4.
Page 4?
Yes. Line 202. Should that be a 2-year storm or 20-year storm?
202.
Because you have twice and then line 11. runoff in a two-year storm considered the same as for a 100-year storm? That doesn't seem possible.
I think it was 2 years.
Is there such a thing as a two-year storm?
I think what he was trying to illustrate was the difference between a minor storm and a major storm.
Okay.
So we're good there.
Yeah.
Okay.
Was there a motion?
Was there a motion?
Yeah, you did. Didn't you?
I've asked for
a motion.
Oh, so moved.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Abstentions? I'm abstaining. I wasn't. Thank you. Okay, the Special Planning Commission meeting minutes, February 7th, 2017. I'll have to say here on this, I'd like to change one thing. Line 16-17 is Robert Kulikowski and not Ron LeFondre.
And again on 39.
And again on 39. Thank you.
Yep.
Get that, Janet?
Well, that's
change.
Ron to me.
Ron to you.
Yeah, thank you. Any other changes?
Line 17 and 18, there's a sentence in there. It says, Chairman Rice noted rules governing the commission, et cetera, et cetera. That was a comment that I made during the January 24th meeting.
Oh, really? I didn't write these.
No, I know.
I don't believe
I said that during the special meeting.
So you want to take that sentence
out? You want to
out?
Believe that?
I'd like to strike that.
Okay.
Okay.
I think you did say that.
Yeah. I don't know.
You upstairs?
Did. Yeah, that we were talking about whether we had a quorum or not. And we said,
I don't know.
Well, there were five.
I know we did. The subject came up.
But there were five people there.
If you look at the minutes from the 24th, it's
the same.
Exactly the same.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Maybe you repeat yourself.
But I thought we had asked that question if the rules applied for a special meeting.
Strike it.
Please strike it.
Please strike it. Make a motion. I'd like to entertain a motion to accept the meeting minutes for this February 7th, 2017 special meeting of the Planning Commission as amended.
So moved.
Second.
I second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions?
I abstained. I wasn't there.
Okay.
Thank you very much, everybody.
Very good. Okay. On to old business. Currently, we have no public hearings open. If you remember, on January 24th, we did close the public hearing for application 1602. That's the 80 Climax Road. 8-30G application, and just want to make a note that this commission does need to render a decision by March 30th. Okay, so we're abiding by the 65-day time period, and so at this time, the commission is free to make comments, begin deliberations, ask questions of town staff or town council. So, Elizabeth, did you have something with that?
Yeah, I had a series of related questions to the town council. And it's regarding the difference between, without getting into numbers, but generally speaking, the difference between the town standard and the state standard regarding sightline regulations. And according to the information we have received, the proposal from the applicant does not meet the town standards, but does meet the state standards. And the applicant is arguing that the state standards should or could apply. I think that sort of summarizes the current situation. So my question is, if the the applicant is requesting a waiver of the town standards, for the distance on sightline. If the town gave that waiver, and an accident were to occur at some point, either a car passing on Climax Road, or a child exiting Hendricks Road, or a runner or bicyclist on Climax Road, or whatever sort of collision between vehicles, and from the side where the sight line requirement is not reached according to town standards, could the town be sued for failure to apply its own safety regulations? So that's the first question. Obviously, insurance companies would kick in to cover accidents or injuries, but could this town be sued?
Do you want an answer tonight, or do you want me to
write it? Okay, so that's the first part of the question. And the second part of the question or a comment would be, if we were to decide to waive our own regulation, no, let me back up. Do we have a record of how many times we have waived that regulation since it's been in existence for any kind of development? And third, associated with that, if we keep these records, would the police department have any record of accidents occurring at those locations?
I think the best way to proceed is to collect questions and then prepare a response and circulate it in writing.
So, piggybacking on Elizabeth's, would it matter if the town could be sued or not? Like, can we factor that into a decision? Do you know what I mean? I don't, so that would be my question. I mean, it's a good question, but I'm not sure if that's something that we can take under advisement, whether or not this town can be sued for us to make a decision on the E30G. That would be my question.
I would rephrase it slightly differently. What liability?
Okay.
What liability and risk? Because anybody can be sued. You know, filing lawsuits in Connecticut.
Right.
It's a very easy thing to do. And real issue is, if sued, what is the potential liability that arises from deviation from the town standard versus the so-called state standard? And I'm not sure there's a waiver involved here as much as you're being asked to apply a different standard. You're not being asked to waive anything. I think what the applicant is saying is under 8-30G, all the standards go out the window. And the test is whether or not the proposal under any standard meets the health, safety, and welfare criteria. But we'll look at that.
Then I guess that question on the history, where I asked how many times has it been waived, then it would be how many times have we applied the Connecticut statute instead of the state.
Slightly different statute. Way to rephrase the question. But I understand what you're trying to determine. You know, how often does this happen? And when it has happened, has it resulted in accident history as a sole proximate cause of the applying a different standard? That sole proximate cause standard is really the standard of liability arising from the design, the highway defect.
That to me would make more sense rather than whether we could be sued or not. You know, that's the scenario.
What liability, potential liability, comes from applying the so-called state standard versus the standard found in the town regulations, town manual, I guess. So I understand what you're looking for.
I had a couple. I want to, in cases where the information you're giving conflicts with each other pretty regularly, where there's strong opinions, both sides cite this, cite that. if you're trying to determine how safe a condition is, let's say that I wanted to build a house. Mm-hmm. For some reason, I was immune to building codes. Maybe I'm in Oklahoma, and I want to build a house according to Simsbury codes because I believe they're good codes and they'll give me a safe structure. Can I use a statute as a guideline to what is safe without sticking to every detail in the regulation?
You mean pick and choose?
Meaning that I look at the regulation and I say the regulation is promulgated on the notion of creating a safe condition. Without citing the regulation as something I'm trying to adhere to, maybe pick and choose. Can I say that if there's a standard that calls for something 100, can I assume that 50 is mm-hmm. not as safe as 100 based on the statute saying 100? You understand?
Yes.
That's one question. Another one is a specific question I had. There was testimony that on the conduct, the stopping distance is considered a safety issue, why sight lines are more an operational efficiency standard. I'd like to understand that better, see if that's true.
Where are you?
I'm picking it out of our minutes, but it's page 14, lines 703, 704, 5, and 6. Also, I'd like to know, I think there was some discussion about regulations derived from Section 7 versus Section 8 of the state statute. I'd like to know which is which, if there's a difference in how that's interpreted.
We are all waiting for the appellate court on that very issue.
Then that's my answer. So,
but we can frame the issue for you. Title 8 is the Zoning Enabling Act. Title 7 is the general grant of power to municipalities. And the issue is whether or not 8-30DG waives standards in both Title 8 and Title 7. The case that's before the appellate court right now is on the sole issue of whether or not Title VII standards must be waived to comply with the 8-30G statute. And on one side of the argument is the party who's in the town. It says only those standards that arise from Title VIII are waived under 8-30G, and the other party says, oh no, both Title VII standards and Title VIII standards fall under the requirement of 8-30G. And the Title VII standard there was, what, a sidewalk? Or, Jamie, you know all about the case. No?
it was about, you're referring to the Brenmore versus
yes.
Town of Lisbon. It involved town ordinance versus subdivision regulation.
Right, town ordinance. Power to enact town ordinances comes out of Title VII. Power to enact subdivision regulations comes out of Title VIII. And I guess it would be the town took the position that 8-30G requires that planning commissions or planning and zoning commissions waive those standards that find their origin in Title VIII and are not required to waive those standards that find their origin in Title VII. Very interesting issue. But unfortunately for you, that decision will probably not be issued until around Memorial Day. So,
well, but it seems to me that
so you can't be guided by it in one way or the other.
Yeah. Okay.
But we do have the lower court decision, which Lou has cited to us in one of the briefs that he has submitted. Brenwood's appellate court decision is now before this. In Connecticut's good work, I'm sorry.
But isn't it reasonable for someone to use their decision making not in fear of something that might happen, but just what is known now. Is that obscure enough for you? You know what I'm saying? That concern that something might be reversed and you don't know if it will be or not doesn't have to enter into your decision making.
No, that's right. But Bryn Mawr, as we sit here today, is an appellate court decision, and we're going to have to look at that and tell you what that says.
That's later.
No, Bryn Mawr is, what happened was Bryn Mawr went to the trial court, got sent up to the appellate court, got appealed to the appellate court, and then the appellate court issued its decision, and the Supreme Court is now reviewing the appellate court. So it's gone all the way up to the Supreme Court because it's sort of a core issue to 8-30G. It's a very narrow issue, but it's a core issue for 8-30G.
And just for clarity, at the Superior Court level, the courts sided with the applicant that ordinance wasn't pertinent to the subject matter. The appellate court agreed with Superior Court. The town then appealed or asked the Supreme Court to take the matter up, and that was argued, and they're waiting for a decision.
So you can answer the question, something in writing?
Yes.
In cases where there's conflicting testimony, if you feel that you need to pick a side, do you need to be an expert in the subject, or can you just use your best judgment and say, I just am not swayed by the arguments of one side or the other?
If the commission were to find that the expert testimony you heard on all issues or any individual issue was from a qualified expert, meaning that their background and education and training and experience qualified them to speak as an expert on the issue they were speaking on, then it's up to you as a commission to give greater weight to one conclusion of one expert versus the other. And in this particular case, you had experts on a number of issues that came to very different conclusions. It will be up to you to review that material and decide which expert to give greater weight to. That's your job as the commission.
And your rationale for it.
Now, you know, on appeal, courts look unkindly to commission members who say, I don't care what any expert says, I know there's too much traffic out there. And every traffic report is, you know, or I don't care what any expert says, it's perfectly safe. You know, the court is going to look, if this were to be appealed, your decision, whatever it is, were to be appealed, the court will look, sort of common sense, but the court will look for the reasoning the commission used in coming to one conclusion or another, citing the evidence that you had before you.
Would an asterisk to that be that you have personal experience with a site that led you to believe it's not safe?
Court cases have said that commission members are allowed to use the personal knowledge and experience of an area. I think you're well advised to do that, but do it in a way that you can tie back to your conclusions as to what the experts have told you. For instance, a hypothetical would be a traffic expert says that intersection with post-development level of service won't change. If a commission member were to say, well, I go through that intersection every morning on my way to work, and I really don't think the additional 40 trips would change the level of service, or vice versa. I go through there every morning, and that Dunkin' Donuts is backed up, the intersection's backed up, and any additional traffic to me seems like it would be a diminution of the level of service, so I agree with expert B. So the court does not presume that you have no knowledge of your town as commission members. That's why you're here, is because you do have knowledge of your town and the circumstances surrounding the site.
Because I think it's a great question, Ellen, about, because there were dueling experts. No, criminal trial, and you have to do it. So, you know, even with knowledge, that's what I'm kind of struggling with. You know, how do you...
You go through...
I know, but it's...
Everything you heard.
Who was more persuasive?
Okay.
Who carried their burden of persuasion with you?
I have a related question to that.
You don't know? That's your answer?
Yeah, that's fine. I'm just, I think it's a great question, and we, you know.
It requires you to have a lot of hope.
Yeah.
The threshold issue is, did you find both experts on any given issue to be qualified? You know, I'm not suggesting, you know, you heard their resume, you heard their experience, because I think you'll need to say something about, we heard from both experts, and one or both were qualified and experts in their field or something like that. And then, because if the person speaking to you as an expert you didn't find qualified, it would be difficult to give the way of persuasion to that expert.
Can I have one more about the interviewer?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that'll be a separate decision.
Right, that's a proceeding within the proceeding.
And that proceeding within the proceeding can only deal with what the intervener status is with regard to this issue.
Environmental, yes, the environmental.
We had other testimony on other issues,
mm-hmm.
because the same attorney used the same experts for both purposes.
Correct.
To some degree. Okay, so, but when it comes to that one specific issue, the intervener, it's all about the environment. Can you give me the exact words?
Yes, I brought it with me so I could read it to you exactly as it is. The conduct which has or is reasonably likely to have the effect of unreasonably polluting, impairing, or destroying the public trust in the air, water, or other natural resources of the state. Reasonably, and I'll send you a version of this letter. Reasonably likely to have the effect of unreasonably polluting, impairing, or destroying the public trust in the air, water, or other natural resources of the state. Now you have to apply that standard under 22A19, and the courts have said the only thing the Planning Commission can apply that to is those areas for which you have jurisdiction over the environmental impact. What is it you regulate under your regulations? You heard a lot of testimony about species and habitat and things like that. The issue for you is, well, for us to give you guidance on it, does the Planning Commission have jurisdiction to regulate those areas? And we'll guide you through that without giving you the ultimate conclusion. We'll tell you what your jurisdiction is, and then you apply that standard. Now,
that'll be part of what you're writing.
Yes. Now, the other part about that is courts have said that in making that determination, you need to have heard or need to find that you have specific quantifiable evidence of unreasonably polluting, impairing, or destroying the public trust in the air, water, and natural resources. It's probably not enough under the court cases interpreting this statute to rely on generalized statements about potential negative impact to be reasonably polluting, impairing, or destroying. Reasonably likely to unreasonably pollute. There's nothing you can undertake in the way of development or any change to the land that's going to have zero impact on the air, water, natural resources. By definition, there's going to be some impact. The standard for the statute is that impact reasonably likely to be unreasonable. And in order to make that determination, you will have to find that you heard specific quantifiable impact on those areas within your jurisdiction.
Well, I'd appreciate some guidance as to what polluting means.
Right.
Okay. I'd like to know things about erosion, runoff, if that's part of the intervener.
Just for clarity, the erosion has to cause an environmental harm. That's unreasonable. And that has been quantified.
Right.
It can be just, there's a likelihood of this to occur.
Right.
The likelihood of it occurring is a cause and effect.
Yeah, the word is, in the statute, polluting, impairing, or destroying. Polluting, impairing, or destroying. Not compare that to having an impact on. That impact has to rise to a level of pollution, impairment, or destruction.
After that, I read the testimony.
Yes, you'll have to make a determination whether what you heard in the testimony rises to that threshold in a specific, quantifiable way.
So that quantifiable applies to runoff everything?
It applies to all of the alleged pollution, impairment, or destruction cited by the interveners. So you will make a determination, probably first, on whether or not the interveners have met their burden. Now, the wrinkle under 8-30G is if they have met the burden, it's the commission's job to explore feasible and prudent alternatives, not the, in the regular proceeding, it's the applicant's job. But you only get to that point if you find that the intervener met their burden of proving.
So that'll be part of what you write up to.
Yeah.
Okay. I need to chew on this.
Yeah. It sounds sort of complicated, but it really boils down to some fairly intuitive common sense concepts. 22A19 is a so-called Private Attorney General Act, which allows any citizen to bring an action and intervene in any proceeding to protect the air, water, and other natural resources of the state. And the courts over the years that this has been in place for quite a while, have gotten very specific and narrow about how this applies in individual proceedings. And the Planning Commission has less environmental jurisdiction than, say, in the Wetlands Commission.
Right.
Because of the nature of your regulations. Your jurisdiction has to be found in either your regulations or in the statutes.
Okay. I'll go quietly now.
Just like
I have three questions.
Uh-huh.
And actually my third one is a direct follow-on to what you said. Is the consideration of well water quality of the neighbors part of the health, safety, and welfare considerations of the impact?
Well, there's two issues there. One is that a valid consideration under your regulations in the statute, and if so, what level of evidence do you need to make it part of your consideration?
Thank you. Okay.
Because you heard people say that if this is built as designed, it will have a negative impact on my well. And we need to guide you through whether that meets the standard of reliable evidence. You know, it's downgrading for me. There'll be additional runoff. My well is downgraded from the site, and it, you know, without, if that's the extent of the testimony you heard, is that enough to go beyond speculation and conjecture to actual evidence of real potential negative impact on our well?
Well, I think we need to go through all of the intervener expert testimony.
And lastly is, you know, you heard two sides of that. One is there'll be no additional runoff from the site. You heard that any number of times. And then you also heard, of course there will be. you know, I've lived here all my life, and the way the site is pitched, there'll be runoff, and I have a well, and it'll spoil my well. So you'll have to weigh that testimony and decide which testimony to give greater weight to.
Which segues into my next question. There was considerable discussion of the methodology for assessing runoff rates.
Yes.
The rational methodology versus TR-55. So I have a couple questions on that. The first one being, if you could give us guidance as to if one takes precedence over the other.
Probably can't, but your town engineer might have something to say.
Okay, the town engineer could.
What we'll do is we'll gather up all the questions, then we'll meet with Jamie and town engineer, whoever else could be helpful in answering these questions, and then we'll put together written responses to them.
The second part of that question is also for the town engineer. There was discussion, Mr. Cork said, well, if the rational method isn't acceptable, then there would be problems all over town because that's the town standard, and there would be problems with runoff all over town. Well, I live on a road that was designed to town standards, both with the sidelines and with the runoff, and we do have a problem. We have a problem where water runoff freezes and creates a very hazardous situation on Hallview Drive. Mm-hmm. Fortunately, there's only 7 houses on the entire street, so we all know how to go around it. It's not a big road. But around the corner on Terry's Plains going to, on the road going to Terraville from Terry's Plains, my son was in a van that slid off the road due to water this year. And after we had our last meeting here, our last public meeting here, at midnight as I was going to the airport to pick somebody up, that whole road was closed and there were lots of police vehicles and ambulances in that same spot that a van full of children had, or teenagers had slid off the road. So I would like, as Elizabeth asked, if the town engineer has any reports of other areas, and if, especially that corner, if that's evidence that maybe that methodology hasn't always served as well.
I think it would be unwise to observe some conditions somewhere else around town and conclude from that the cause of that harmful condition arose from the standard that was used. I understand where you're coming from, where there's a sheeting of water over a road, especially this time of year, that can quickly freeze, that creates a dangerous condition. And your knowledge and observation of that is part of the equation, but I don't think it would be correct to say that resulted from the application of the rational standard at that location. But we'll talk to the town engineer and we'll see if he has something else to say on that, because there may be all other kinds of factors involved in that particular location that may not be present here. It may be a very old road with absolutely no engineering associated with it. But we'll work through all that. But I do understand your point.
Okay, thank you. And the last question is, I'm still puzzled by the calculus of affordability. And I would just like if someone on the staff, maybe Jamie, could walk us through those calculations that ended up with the affordable houses being, I think, $275,000. And how does that, vis-a-vis, let's say, if the rest of the neighborhood is assessed at around that same level, does that mean, is there a calculus by which several homes that already meet that price range should be endangered by just two more, the addition of 2 or 3 more?
Mr. Chairman, we can explain the math behind 8-30G. Remember, when they submit an application to you, they have to take a snapshot in time. 830G evolves as products move in and out of sale or rent on a project. So the affordable price in February of 2017 may not be the same price that unit is available in 2021 or 2028. It's based on a calculation associated with the median income of the area, mm-hmm. and that median income changes. Also, additional costs associated with utilities and other factors also affect the price. So it's a moving number. It's meant not to be fixed in time, but it moves with time and with the economy. But I can absolutely walk you through that calculation.
Right. The other issue with 8-3G is, of course, the affordable units are deed restricted affordable units. So the other housing in the immediate neighborhood that may be at that level today can rise and fall with the market. So the unit that would sell in the adjacent neighborhood, 275 right now because of the depressed market, maybe 350 2 years from now, whereas the affordable units in the 8-30G development have to stay affordable for the affordability period with a deed restriction. That's the distinction between an affordable unit under 8-30G and housing that is currently priced affordably generally in the area.
You can achieve an increase in price of the affordable unit in correlation with an increase in median income.
Right.
Without an increase in median income, in essence, the price of the home for that deed-restricted time cannot increase. If median income falls, the price is adjusted to reflect the fall of the median income. So if someone paid $300,000 paid at a fixed median income, if that goes up, the sale of the house could go up beyond $300,000. But if median income falls and they go to sell the unit, a new calculation has to occur. Every time the unit is sold, they have to meet the calculation.
So the owner could be stuck with the difference?
Yes.
No different than a normal homeowner, because if median income's dropping, the economy is weak in an area, which typically is reflective in sales price. So, and that's how in the 90s and 2000s people got upside down on houses.
Yeah, I'd like you to
comment
on how pertinent that is to our decision making.
You mean the effect on neighboring properties?
We wouldn't be able to offer anything on...
That's outside of our jurisdiction.
I can't tell you what impact three additional units in that neighborhood have on the pricing of available sale houses. But we can tell you what the statute says. We can tell you what the affordability plan, mm-hmm. how it works, and limitations on it. We'll leave it to your judgment what impact that has on
it. The applicant submitted at least two affordability plans.
Yes.
If I remember correctly. That detailed it, form.
You're going to have to find, with our help, that those affordability plans meet the requirement of the statute. That's also the requirement of
the original affordability plan submitted with the application had some minor errors in it. Their subsequent submission corrected those errors.
So we really should have the staff verify.
We can walk you through.
Yeah. We'll walk you through it, and you'll have to make a finding whether it does or does not meet the statute based on the information you provide.
I will say the sales price of units in this house, this development, and their effect on the abutters, my understanding of 830G is not something you can consider in your decision-making process.
I have a question related to that. Could we have our most recent figures on the number of affordable housing units in Simsbury?
We can.
I don't think we got that.
We can look at that. But it really is not material to your decision making.
Yeah. Well,
you do not meet the 10%.
Right.
Well, that affects your decision making.
Yeah, well, we understand.
Right. I would like to know what exactly it is.
But we need to clarify that because it's 10% is only government financed housing, right? I believe there is far more than 10% of the housing stock in that price range. When I went on to realtor.com, 43% of all the houses offered were at or below that, that price. 43%.
Again, 8-30G allows an applicant to use a section of the statutes to submit an application that has a different set of standards that you have to review it under. And it's allowed when the town does not have 10% of their housing stock meeting the definition of affordability under 8-30G. It's not based on what's on Zillow. It's not based on what's on Realtor.com. It's based on the housing stock that meets the definition of affordability.
Statutory definition of affordability.
And for all intents and purposes, it's either government subsidized or mortgaged program.
There is no question here that 8-30G statute applies to Simsbury when the applicant made their application.
But our decision making doesn't have much to do with the efficacy of this affordable housing.
No, it does not.
The math, okay? That's what we need to understand. That's not what we're talking about. It's of interest, but it's not what we're talking about.
It's part of the background information that you would want to be perhaps knowledgeable of. But it's probably under the statute. It's probably not an appropriate standard for you to apply in making a decision on the application. The statute tells you what the standards are, and the case is interpreting the statute. So we're going to help you understand that and make your decisions based on the statute. I mean, the big picture here is this 8-30G is part of Title VIII, where the state legislature years and years ago made a decision to essentially override in municipal powers of zoning and say this is a statewide policy. For those towns that fall under this criteria, 8-30G sets a different set of standards for subdivisions for planning commissions to consider. The Zoning Enabling Act is state law grants you the power to write subdivision regulations, and state law clearly has the authority to override that power for this purpose. So, I mean, that's in that context needs to be kept in mind. This statute is in furtherance of a state policy that goes back many years that the legislature has determined is in the best interest of the state of Connecticut. And if you look up proposed bills today in this legislature, you'll probably see 30 of them that want to do something one way or the other with 8-30G. But until they make it all the way to the governor's signature, even if they did, it wouldn't apply to this application. But so it's the statute is as it reads. We're going to help you understand that and apply it to this application.
So across the state, do you have any idea how many 8-30G applications have been filed?
We can provide that number.
We can get that number.
I'd be interested in not only in the number, but in the context of the rulings. So if you just direct us towards, I don't know if that's public record that's available online.
I have seen information about percentage of commissions that prevail on appeal versus percentage of applicants that prevail on appeal under 8-30G. And we can provide that for you to give you a sense of how the courts interpret commission action on 8-30G applications.
How about before it gets to appeal, a positive ruling on the initial application versus a denial?
Yeah, that might be difficult to capture. I don't know anyone who keeps those sorts of records because, well, we can look at it. make some sort of judgments about how many decisions go to appeal by one party or another.
The only caution I will make is that you need to make your decision based on the information contained in the record.
Yes.
And there may be some questions that have come up today that after Bob and I reflect on the questions you're posing, we may make a determination that they were not part of the public record.
I think the relevance of that sort of information is to give you some guidance as to how much discretion courts grant commissions in deciding F-30Gs. Because every time we have workshops and training sessions, we always tell you that courts give great discretion to the commissions to commissions that take action on applications under their own regulations, as long as there's no procedural errors and stuff, unlawful. And 8-30G changes those rules, because the burden would be on you in an appeal to carry the burden to defend whatever decision you make. But Jamie's absolutely correct. The only information that counts in this application is what's in your record and how we help you interpret that record against the standards.
Any guidance you can give us now? Personally, I'm going to go back and start reviewing the testimony.
Yeah, I think that review the testimony. I think this commission should be very proud of its proceedings so far. I think you've done a good job of managing the public hearing and allowing all parties to have their say. And it's going to be a very complete record if it goes to appeal one way or the other. And I will not have a difficult time arguing to the court that no matter what decision you make, it was based on a very diligent review of all the facts and circumstances. And that's why we kept counseling you at every turn, let it in, let it come into the record, because we want a full record and we don't want to get caught up on a procedural issue. I think you did that very well.
I have one final question. Regarding experts, we had, I don't know, maybe 40 residents speaking up, all of whom, I believe, were in opposition to the proposal. I don't remember anyone supporting it. Can we consider them experts? Because none of them are professional engineers. I believe one person said he was an engineer. How much weight can we give to their arguments?
It depends on what they said. If what they said dealt with facts, and they're speaking essentially as fact witnesses, then you can consider that. If someone said, I've lived in this neighborhood for 40 years and I've observed the following for 40 years, that to me would be fact testimony, and you would give that weight in determining what the facts are. I don't know that. Neighbors can talk about generalized traffic conditions in an area. What courts, a lot of decisions I've seen, especially recently, don't uphold commission decisions on based on, 45 people came to the hearing and were opposed to it, therefore we're opposed to it too. Especially in the 8-30G context, that's...
But if someone says, I drive out every day and somebody almost hit me, do we count that as testimony? Is that anecdote? They don't have proof of it.
Certainly anecdotal.
Right. They don't have a photograph of it. They don't have a police report on it. They don't have witness statements saying, I saw that happen.
I think you're asking all the right questions as to you individually, what weight you would give that sort of testimony. It's certainly relevant, but it's an issue of how much weight you would give that sort of testimony. Because you don't know all the facts and circumstances that surround that particular incident. Do you have anything to say to that,
I think when you have expert testimony with regards to traffic volumes and lane width and safety associated with the traveled way, you have to put a lot of effort into the belief in those statements. I think we all could consider situations on any road we've ever driven as drivers where you've almost gotten an accident and almost maybe had an incident either with a pedestrian or a bicyclist. Does that mean that that road was not safe? Or does it mean that either you had a lapse in your judgment or the individual either walking or biking was biking in an unsafe manner? In most instances, it's similar. There has to be a cause and an effect, and the cause and the effect has to be directly related to this development. Take the development away. That same situation existed prior to this development. The addition of 19 homes, will that substantially change the nature of the roadway? You're looking at a road that carries 1,000 cars a day, based on the testimony in that range. Will the addition of 19 homes systematically affect the safety of that road? Not the connection to it, just the motoring public down that road. If it carried 1,000 cars a day, adding 50 more to it, I'm just using 50 as a number, but if we looked at the traffic volume proposed for this development, adding that volume to that roadway, devoid of the discussion on sightline, but just adding additional volume to that roadway, does that impact the functionality of that road with regards to safety? And I believe you have testimony in the record regarding that. I mean, I walk across the street every day, or every other day, and potentially could tell you that Hop Meadow is not safe. But that may be because I'm not always in the crosswalk, or people are not always in
or
the
texting
right
somebody
mind.
Somebody.
I'm driving down Hop Meadow, because they're not always looking for a pedestrian. Doesn't mean that Hop Meadow's not safe, or that 10 more cars on Hop Meadow make it less safe. I think, Elizabeth, in your questioning, I think in asking these questions and making the statements out loud, I think you're also potentially able to answer them by just stating them.
So we'll put together a response to your questions and outline the standards on both the intervener petition and the 8-30G application. When do you meet next? When's the next meeting?
Yeah, 28th of February. 2 weeks from
now. 2 weeks from February. We could probably have something to you by then, I think. And then, you know, digest it and maybe you'll think of additional questions.
Mr. Chairman, on the 28th, would you feel as a commission it would help if the town engineer was present that evening? If there were any specific questions you may have for him based on his testimony or...
It's written up everything, it seems to me. Unless you feel you need him to answer something he asked tonight. But, seems to me it's all written up.
There's Holly's question about the TR, whatever, versus the rational method, which should go to the engineer, correct?
Yeah. But then we can, versus having him here, I'm sure Jeff Shea can articulate that very clearly in a memo.
Yeah. Well, we'll send you the memo, and if you say, I'd really like to, you know, ask additional questions on that, then we could ask him if he could attend and give you the opportunity to discuss it in more detail. Because if you ask me a specific question about the rational method or TR24, my response is going to be, I don't know. Other than what I heard at the same time you heard it.
You have 2 weeks to see.
Yeah, that's true. That's true.
And again, I was looking specifically to his experience in town as to whether had a different method been used, if it had been designed differently, conditions would be different.
Right.
So working backwards, if March 30th is the last day.
You meet three more times before that date.
Right. So I would expect that we would have language and a draft action or a decision no later than the 28th of March.
You would need to.
That's right.
What I would potentially anticipate, Mr. Chairman, is I think the discussion was good tonight that you had. Bob and I have a little bit of work to do with the town engineer with regards to the questions you had this evening. I think you'll deliberate the responses, and then perhaps after the next meeting in February, you would perhaps give staff some direction to either you're going to formulate a motion on your behalf as a commission member, or you're going to ask council to develop the guidelines associated with a motion and try and bring your words into the form of a legal motion.
Because again, under 830G, under a regular application, the court will search the record to find one or more reasons that supports a decision. 830G is a little bit different. You have to specifically articulate your
In the decision.
So that's why it takes more care in preparing.
Well, that this is my concern, because there's not a lot of time. And, you know, for sure we won't be able to have a draft resolution at our next meeting because we're waiting for input. To expect it on the 14th of March, which would be 2 weeks after that, our next meeting.
That sounds like it could work. Depending on
That's expecting that the commission will give direction on the 28th.
Right.
Okay, if we're still not through with our deliberations, it could postpone it another meeting.
Correct.
The way I see it is we have about one meeting buffer at the most.
Unless you want to have a special meeting.
Right.
Well, we'll try to get this put together as soon as we can to give you a maximum amount of time to look it all over. Some of it goes quicker than others.
So in the meantime, I'll ask the commission to start reviewing the testimony. Okay, I believe it's still all on that box folder that that Carrie put together for us. You know, it's under a nice folder, I think 80 Climax Road. But what's not there are the meeting minutes, but those are available on the town website.
We can, if it would help you, we could grab all of those and put them in one place.
I think I'd like
that. You'd prefer to have it in one spot.
And if we can, volunteer my staff, what we'll do is we'll pull the pertinent sections from the hearing. In essence, have it read like a book. So you will just, you know, public hearing, all of the agenda items before and after will eliminate, and we'll just have the hearing testimony.
That would be great.
So you can read it literally, you wouldn't know which night you're at, you'll read it from the beginning to the end.
Can I ask if it's possible? Sometimes when things are placed on Dropbox, I have an awful time finding what it is. Can we use identifiers? You know what I'm saying?
We have 99 plus exhibits.
Well, right. Well, that's my point. Okay, so if you put minutes up as I-29 instead of calling it minutes, it's just hard for me to find it. I have to go by what was put up last date and open it up and see what it really is.
Can you put a title on things?
Yeah. You can look at
it. Or just give us a code. Said that, you know, look for item number so and so.
We'll look at that.
I have a tough time finding what's new.
Like a table of contents or something. Mm-hmm.
Well, but you're going to put it in one document, so
we're going to put the meeting minutes in one box.
There's several documents.
Yeah, I know that. Much.
And I have a stack of paper now.
Yeah.
I'm not quite sure, and a lot of the plans have changed, and so what's in Dropbox is the latest and greatest. And if we have something that isn't in Dropbox, we have old news, right? Like, I have lots of site plans.
The record you are making a decision on contains items 1, we'll say through 100. the most recent plans were submitted at the January 24th meeting, and we'll double check the revision dates and clarify that. The plan set you're looking for are sheets 1 through X with a final revision date of this. We'll make sure.
So that's what X is.
But it doesn't mean you can't look back at all any historic drawing or document to see how the project's evolved.
But it's but we can't base anything on it because it's changed officially.
You are making a decision based on the record. Again, the final set of plans they want you to make a decision on are the ones that were submitted on January 24th.
Those are dated, the plans. I don't have them in front of me.
Yes.
Okay. Because I've got
for this reason, I don't have stuff.
Most of the sheets will have revision date in the box in the corner.
Yeah, there was a little, I think, they a little mix-up when they were looking at the sightline plans. You know,
it wasn't a mix-up. There are two plans that contradict each other.
Right. For different reasons.
They're both grading plans.
Yep.
One grading plan is different than the other grading plan. They were prepared by two different engineers.
And they use both at different times.
And you clarified that at the last meeting, didn't you? I remember seeing that in the minutes, I think.
Yeah there was some discussion.
Staff pointed out an inconsistency between two different plan sheets.
Okay, anything else on this application number 1602 at this point? Okay. You guys have some homework? We'll look forward to seeing that. And we have some homework. There's a lot of material. Okay. Can't say that you shouldn't take your time, but we have to get through it. Okay. All right, next on the agenda, application number 17-01 of Dorset Crossing LLC owner for the revision of the layout of the temporary cul-de-sac, resulting in a re-subdivision of the properties located at 115 Castor Bridge Crossing. Okay, so we received this application at our last meeting.
Yes.
And established the public hearing to open on March 14th, 2017.
Correct.
And that'll be here at 7 o'clock.
I think we're still working on a location for the 14th. The 14th may actually be at Eno Hall in the youth room. And again, when we do the legal notices, we will have to solidify our meeting space. But it will be that night. It will be at 7 p.m. Just as we enter budget season, things ramp up a little bit with the utilization of this room.
For budget stuff.
Yeah.
I would expect there'd be someone presenting a plan.
Absolutely.
Okay. Can I make a suggestion with the agreement of the commission that we put this application prior to number 1602 that night?
We can do that.
Because we'll be deliberating on 1602.
We'll adjust the agenda.
Make it a little more convenient for the applicant for 1701.
And that one just went before the Conservation Commission. They are in the process of making some revisions. There's an existing culvert. If everybody's familiar, this is...
Just on way in the back?
Yeah, this. If everybody knows where Dorset Crossing is, and East Point was built off
there's a
Hot Meadow, just north of the International Skating Center. The new development just to the north of that, it just past the substation, it stops, it goes across a stream, and then there was a cul-de-sac designed for that. They want to change the cul-de-sac, in essence, to an offset cul-de-sac for the redevelopment of that parcel on the south side of the brook. In doing so, they need to make some revisions to the road layout and the culvert crossing. So they originally proposed a 4-foot by 6-foot box culvert where they would not be introducing the stream bed into it, and through work of staff with the developer and suggestions of the Conservation Commission, they will be reestablishing this. Our suggestion is to reestablish the stream channel So instead of having a natural stream bottom that goes into a box culvert for 60 or 80 feet and then goes back into a stream channel, what they do is you'll increase the size of the box culvert and you'll reestablish a stream channel within the box culvert. And so for the environment, there is a change in conditions, but not a substantial change in conditions from a nice natural stream bottom to a concrete dump.
Okay.
This many way, and this might be off course, but I have been told by, when I was on the Economic Development Task Force, that development, that Dorset Crossing, there was going to be another traffic relieving road similar to Iron Horse that would relieve traffic and go around Hot Meadow. Does this impact that at all?
No.
Is that going to actually happen?
That right now may be financially constrained.
That would go out to the county road?
It was on the north side.
Yeah.
It actually would be a new connection on the north side of the existing urgent care facility, kind of behind that retail and office building, come back through the substation, then go all the way out to Hoskins.
And
the financial, it's a town financial issue?
There would be probably some combined financial responsibility there.
Okay, under new business, are we in receipt of any new applications?
No, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Okay, now under general commission business, we have the POC update. So, Jamie, to be honest with you, I thought we'd be meeting with Glenn tonight.
Glenn's at the listening session at Henry James.
When we met on the 7th, it was my impression that we were going to have an opportunity to discuss the booklets that he's been sending out.
Again, given the requirement of and meeting at Henry James, that was not able to occur this evening. And speaking with Glenn, and I know I've sent those emails to you as part of that email chain, and we talked 2 weeks ago about a special meeting, and looking at our calendars, we have picked kind of two dates right now, which would be next Thursday evening, where Glenn would come in and update the entire commission on status, schedule, survey, and the booklets. And he really wants to go through the booklets with you, so as long as there aren't any substantial issues with the conclusions in the booklet, that it can move forward with writing the document. Mm-hmm. That February 23rd meeting would be probably the most important meeting you've had in the last 6 months, devoid of an application that you've had. As a follow-up to that meeting, we also have been discussing over the past few months about having a joint meeting with the Zoning Commission. And in working with the chairman of the Zoning Commission, he feels the best date in common with both commissions would possibly be March 2nd, which is another Thursday evening for a combined meeting. And again, as we've discussed in the past, you're the planning arm of the town, and we've used the terminology, you could write the best POCD that Connecticut has seen, but you are not the implementing arm of the POCD. So I think it's very important to have this combined meeting with the Zoning Commission. And it would occur, in essence, just after you reviewed the booklets. So as a commission with Glenn, he could clearly articulate on your behalf the direction of the POCD and what some of the bigger issues have been and what your intent is and what you're trying to accomplish with the POCD. Okay.
So the proposal is to have a Planning Commission meeting, special meeting, on the 23rd of February.
Yes.
Thursday. And Glenn will be here.
Absolutely.
And we'd have the opportunity to get the update and our comments to the booklets that he has been distributing.
Yes.
Is that the only date he could get?
what we also looked at is that Saturday.
What time on the 23rd?
We would be flexible. If 6 o'clock worked better for people, 6 to 8 or 7 to 9? Or
do you think earlier or later?
I can't do it before 7. I have a commitment just up the street, but until about 7. So I could meet, but not till 7.
You do? How about the 25th? I realize it's a Saturday.
It's a Saturday.
I prefer Thursday if possible, 7 to 9, personally.
I mean, from my perspective, 7:30 to 9:30, I mean, I'm here. So whether I want to say whether I get home at 10:30 or 11, it's the norm.
So Aaron,
I could do 7. I mean, I could, yeah. I mean, if I'm a
7 or thereabouts?
Late, yeah.
Bob, you can't make it. Alan, are you available the 23rd?
Bob, would you be able to have at least a conversation with either Bill or myself regarding any concerns or comments you have? Or even a quick email? Or
I can send that right to Bill.
Okay.
Or you, or copy both of you.
Yes, why don't you do that?
Yeah.
Copy both of us, please.
I just had a question for both the chairman and Jamie. I've diligently read through everything and took lots of notes, and I thought, boy, if everyone has as many notes as I do, it might take more than one or two meetings to get through all this, but we're not really writing the POCD, we're just giving general feedback, correct?
Correct. He's doing wordsmithing. You're just...
Well, but you know, it's not the wordsmithing per se, but I can see, I've spent just enough time with this group to know that, and other groups that, you know, you can spend a lot of time talking about lots of different things, so.
I want to say one of,
although, by the way, that being said, I think he's done a great job.
Yeah. Just,
one of
in
Glenn's
general, I'm very impressed with his work.
Talent are working through the minutiae of a plan and building consensus with the commission. Not his consensus, your consensus as a commission, and moving you along and trying not to bog down on one particular issue.
And I'm just, that's no reflection. I think he's done a great job.
They spent 2 hours at a two and a half hours at a listening session with less than 10 people a month ago. So again, that probably isn't the best scenario, but he will do everything within his ability to move the process along.
And
he needs to start writing.
And speaking of the process, we're also going ahead with the SurveyMonkey.
That's my next.
Let's get the meetings established, please. So, Elizabeth, are you available on the 23rd?
Yes,
I am. So, I think we should go with the 23rd, 7 o'clock. Bob, you can send in comments, as you may have, to the brochures, and Aaron will expect you a little bit late.
Yeah.
Okay, if your plans change, we will expect you on time.
Are we scheduling that joint meeting?
Right, so... Let me just get this one in here.
Do we have to make a motion?
The chairman can call a special meeting.
By fiat.
Do we know how many people made the listening session tonight? Did Michael?
No.
Oh.
I haven't.
You haven't checked?
My phone's on the desk.
It's averaging between 5 and 8, isn't it?
5 and 10. I know the... bike group in town had submitted written comments this afternoon, and they, a few members, were supposed to be in attendance.
Which group?
The bike ped group in town.
Is it flight group?
No, bike ped.
Okay, bike, so that's the 23rd, Jamie. You'll notice that properly?
Yes.
Please, thank you. And then a joint meeting with the Zoning Commission and Planning Commission on March 2nd?
That would be another Thursday evening.
Aaron, okay.
Mm-hmm.
Bob, what do you think of that day?
Oh, it's a Thursday.
Yeah, okay, so Thursdays are difficult for you?
No? It doesn't matter. We go that far out.
Okay. Alan?
Good.
Holly? Elizabeth?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm okay with that too, so we'll do another 7 o'clock, or we want to try to make it a little earlier?
Well, Aaron.
It was just the 23rd I had the issue.
Well, since we're going to have the other commission, do they normally meet at 7 o'clock?
I can, if it's okay, Mr. Chairman, I'll work with Dave Ryan, and I think, would you lean towards 6 o'clock?
I would lean towards 6.
6 to 8, or even if there's a little bit of slippage, you're here to 8:30, but you're not here to 10.
Okay.
I'll work with you and Dave Ryan.
Okay.
But 6 o'clock would be okay for all the commission members?
They don't get any pizza, though.
They can have our crust.
No, we need cooperation.
Remember, the zoning commission is the implementing agency.
That's why they can afford their own pizza.
No, but there are some definite calls for implementation in here. So.
Will they have an opportunity to see the brochures?
We will send them, we'll Dropbox all the booklets.
Okay. I noticed that I am missing brochure booklet number 2.
There is no number 2.
Okay, then I have a full set.
Just, you are not the first to ask.
Is everyone else up to snuff with 1 through 7
minus number 2?
So you gave us 1 and 3.
Excellent.
Because I thought the same thing.
Yep. And 4?
At some point, there'll be a subject index. Is that correct?
Yes. Are you missing 4, Elizabeth?
Yeah, put them in your book.
That'll be the index?
You should have 4. If you do not, just let us know. We have additional copies.
Jimmy, have you thought about doing a glossary of terms set?
Again, what you're seeing are booklets.
Okay.
So those booklets are background information on the plan, but those booklets are not the plan. Those booklets help Glenn form the plan. So again, the POCD will be, 60 to 100 page bound that incorporates those things in the plan. I guess in essence, booklet number 2 is all the demographics and social and economical stuff.
Okay.
That's in the process.
Yeah.
And in some instances, Glenn doesn't do that as a booklet because it would be redundant, because those types of tables and charts just go in the plan to begin with.
So. Okay, could you just talk about...
survey?
Yep, survey. Okay. Surveys.
With regards to the phone survey, Glenn is had the conversation, shared your concerns about how people will react to the phone survey. And again, he is very confident in the company he uses' ability to get the responses. They do not just, again, it's a cold call, but they'll leave a message on an answering machine to say, I am calling on behalf of the town of Simsbury Planning Commission is undertaking a survey for their plan of conservation and development. Please call back. We will, leave the time you want us to call you back. So it's very user-friendly with regards
to... So it's not a robocall.
And again, it's that company's responsibility to get the 400 responses. With regards to SurveyMonkey, Glenn did have concerns that survey would potentially conflict, if not compete, with the phone survey. So he asked me, for the time being, if you would bear with him and go with the phone survey and not, in essence, double load the process with 2 surveys going out to the residents. And again, I would defer that to Glenn's expertise. I'm probably comfortable with that, given the fact that we are going forward with the phone survey. If we weren't going through with the phone survey, we would have already had the draft for you on survey.
Okay, yep.
In our last meeting, when he talked about the timeline, he seemed to indicate that if we put the phone survey in there, we couldn't meet our deadline. Insofar that we're willing to hold extra sessions?
Given the commitment of the commission and his ability to have the meetings on the 23rd and the 2nd, again, that meeting on the 23rd is extremely critical. If the 23rd doesn't build the necessary consensus on the booklets to date, he doesn't have the ability to, in essence, start to write the plan. if you really get bogged down on the minutia of each and every word in that booklet, that's what really concerns
me. I think we should treat it as conceptual, you know?
Yeah.
And you know, let's not get way down in the weeds. We'll have that opportunity when he actually drafts the written version. Okay, but we need to give them good guidance to press on.
And Glenn talked about action words and picking those carefully, and I think as you write the full plan, you'll probably spend time on discussions of shall, should, could, would, need to, and that to me is where you really bog down and should get into the minutia of the final language.
And the step later on. Yes. What we're doing now is covering
his
content.
Goal again is to have the plan.
Content. Right.
Again, speaking with him today, I believe it's his goal to have the plan and draft in April to allow you to review it. Again, that gives him 4 to 6 weeks to write a plan. It's a tight time frame. But again, this is what he excels at.
But he's not writing it from scratch. Okay,
so. Well, you know, I mean, I was impressed how he has really reorganized things. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, I'm very impressed. I'm impressed with his numbering system. It's a lot of work's already, a lot of thoughts already been put.
So the phone surveys ago, February 23rd for meeting and March 2nd for a combined meeting are all goes.
Yep.
Okay. What are PA 490 lands?
PA 490 is a program under state statute where a town can have an out for a landowner with regards to tax implications. So someone can put their land under PA 490, which gives that the assessor the ability to reduce the rate on the land. So if you have agricultural land at the corner of Maine and Maine, and if it was assessed for $1 million, it could be a cornfield. Well, if the farmer had to pay the assessment on $1 million value, he would probably be forced to sell the land because he couldn't afford to pay the taxes on the valuation. Public Act 490 allows that rate to be reduced. There is a promise that the farmer keeps it in 490 for a period of time. If it is sold during that period, the farmer owes the back taxes on the full assessed value. But there's no additional penalty. Some believe there should be, but that's, you know, discussion for the legislature.
You had an item here, mapping under the POC.
It's just, it was a follow-up, Mr. Chairman, on the open space mapping that was done a while ago, and also the I had mentioned 2 weeks ago that we're looking at a project that will incorporate all of that mapping for the open space and easements throughout the town as part of this project.
Okay. It's not currently part of the POCD?
Not to the level we may take it to. And we would either do that through an add-on with Glenn, or we would just do that through engineering and using Rich Schwitzky as a project manager with New England Geo to do that map. We have the funds available. We're just waiting for
the
proposal
done
to be
done by the intern for a couple summers. It was an inventory of the town-owned open space.
Yes.
Is this a continuation of that?
That would, in essence, be a follow-up on that and actually incorporating it into our GIS system with all of that data.
Okay. Anything else?
That is all I have.
Commissioners, anything on the POCD?
How specific can we get? I mean, like, I have specific questions about this. On the 23rd, we can ask them those specific questions.
As specific as you want.
Okay.
And Glenn should have a response or ask, you know.
I mean, they're not hard questions, just some, okay.
Yeah, that will be the opportunity.
Good.
Maybe not the only one, but it is an opportunity.
No, because I took.
You know, but I would hope if someone brought up the issue of, you know, I'm concerned about the number of residential units be built in town, that doesn't become an hour-long discussion of the pros and cons associated with the number of residential units. Okay, we're concerned about the residential units. And Glenn may say, well, the number, the size, the type, or the location? And you may say, all of them. Okay, Glenn now knows that it is a concern of the commission with regards to residential development, size, type, and location. Now maybe he can write a paragraph about that. But again, it should. What we're trying not to do is turn subject matter into hour-long discussion. Yep.
So in April, if he has a draft, I should have that chart in front of me. But then, when do we have to finalize the draft? Is that in?
If you look at a date of, we'll say November 1, 2017. You have to have that plan available on your web page 65 days in advance of the public hearing prior to the adoption of the plan. So you lose all of October and all of September, because that's like a cooling off period. I mean, work still can be done, but in essence, by September 1, you need to have a final draft of that plan up on your web page. And you don't typically meet in August. So he's looking at May, June, and July as your months to make sure it happens. And the difficulty is if he holds a hearing, he really doesn't want to hold any public input hearings in July. So we kind of be lost August and July, so we're really looking at April, May, and June to get your work done.
Does it go into effect in January?
Yeah. No, you potentially, upon a, and a couple things have to happen. You also have to refer it to the Board of Selectmen. The Board of Selectmen have to review it and then send a recommendation to you to adopt, not adopt, or adopt with revisions. You take that under consideration. And all that has to happen prior to your adoption in that 65-day period also. Once you adopt it, if you had a meeting November 1st, you also have to set an effective date. Your effective date can be no sooner than a day after the date of public notice in the newspaper. So you have to do a legal notice. So if you did it on November 1st, it takes us 3 or 4 days to get a legal notice out. So even if you adopted it on November 1st, you couldn't have an effective date of, we'll say, November 7th. So again, every little incremental time affects you. There are provisions contained in state statute, as well as recommended. There are example letters that the Office of Policy and Management has when your plan is not up to date. It affects a town's ability to get discretionary funding, but if the town were to apply for discretionary funding, they can also request a waiver. To my knowledge, any waiver that has been requested has been granted. They have not rejected any waiver requests. And in essence, you know, if you send something to OPM, you could say, we adopted our plan, on November 2nd, if a grant was due. On November 2nd, you would send the waiver request stating that on November 1st, the plan was adopted by the Planning Commission. The effective date was set November 7th, so we're out of compliance for 5 days. And in some instances, I've been involved in a community where their plan was out of date for 5 years. But it never prevented them from getting or applying for or receiving discretionary funds.
There's also a Regional Planning Commission review.
Yes.
Is that happening
in that 65-day time frame? Yeah. And again, the regional agency is looking for compliance with their regional plan as well as the state plan. The state does not review the plan. It's only submitted to them. They'll review it when they prepare their plan of conservation and development, which is already in draft form. So you'll be submitting a plan after the state is preparing their plan.
Elizabeth, did you have another question?
No, I thought it was January. I was looking at this form that we got here. And I saw January, so I was asking, was it January? It's November 1st, state requirement.
Okay. Enough for tonight, folks?
I move that we adjourn.
Second half.
Any discussion? All in favor of adjourning the meeting, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstain? Motion passes unanimously. Thank you, everyone.
Happy
Great
Valentine's
job again.
Day.
Funding for Simsbury Community Television is provided in part by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.